Hi friends, welcome back to CAP classes. In this video lecture, we are going to discuss working capital management. Be it your graduation, post-graduation, or be it a professional course like CA, CWA, CS, or even if you are doing global courses like ACCA, CPA, CMI, USA, this working capital management is a part of your syllabus. It is a part of financial management, and this is highly useful for professional course students who are pursuing commerce and finance courses. So basically, this working capital management is a very big topic. The scope is huge, wide. In this, there are so many subparts, there are so many segments, there are so many different categories of problems what we have to learn in this. So I will divide working capital management from the point of view of scope, and after that we can start learning one by one. So one, working capital requirement forecast. First one is forecasting working capital requirement. That means how much of working capital is to be maintained by a businessman. So what is this? Basically, this is how much of working capital is required to be maintained, is required to be maintained in a business. So simply, this is calculation of working capital requirement. Simply, this is calculation of working capital requirement. This calculation of working capital requirement can be done in two ways. One is through operating cycle. What is the first one? Operating cycle. So we calculate operating cycle. Based on operating cycle, what is the amount of working capital required is to be calculated. Operating cycle, in a very short form, operating cycle is the time required for cash to go through various stages of process and then be converted into cash again. For example, you carried cash, you purchased raw materials, then raw materials are converted into finished goods. During this conversion, it will become work in progress. Finished goods are sold to a customer on credit. Cash is collected from the customer, collections from debtors we call. Then again, cash has become, you know, into cash in your hand. So this is first category. Second category is, second type of calculation is based on current assets and current liabilities. Second one is based on current assets and current liabilities. So the first part in working capital management is understanding how much of amount a businessman has to maintain to meet day-to-day expenses. This is category one of problems. Then category two is inventory management. Category two is inventory management. This inventory management, you know, be it EOQ model, economic order quantity, or be it stock levels, how much of stocks are to be maintained, and be it ABC, always best control, how to control inventory and all various techniques, just in time, all these things are learned in costing. So in financial management, we'll not discuss inventory management much. But if you open ICI study material, there are one, two problems on this, but not a great, you know, difficult problems. Just calculation of EOQ, calculation of EOQ and safety stock is there. This kind of one, two examples are there. So this is second one, inventory management. Third one is cash management, which is very, very, very important. Third one is cash management. So the principle here is cash should not be held in hand, which will make it idle. That means you cannot carry 12 rupees of cash in hand if 10 rupees is required. For example, what is cash required? Cash required is, say, 10 rupees. So if your cash in hand is 12 rupees, what will happen? Cash in hand, if it is 7 rupees, what will happen? So in one situation, you are having more than what is required. In one situation, you are having less than what is required. Here, you will face a problem with liquidity. That means you need 10 rupees. You have only 7 rupees in hand. When you need to pay bills, like, you know, it can be your utility bills, electricity bills, water bills, or any rents and all. Whenever you need to pay any short-term bills, you will not have adequate money. Also, to pay creditors who supplied raw materials to you on credit, on due date, you will not be able to pay. So here, what is the problem? Liquidity problem. Here, you will have liquidity problem. Then you may ask, if I need 10 rupees, if I hold 12 rupees in hand, what will happen? Here, there is an opportunity cost. cash has opportunity cost. So instead of holding this 2 rupees in your hand, which is idle, only 10 rupees is required, you are holding 12 rupees. So instead of holding this 12 rupees, 2 rupees idle cash in your hand, if you invest it somewhere, that cash will have a chance of earning return on investment. So you will lose, you know, that ability, the cash will lose the ability of multiplying, ability of earning more money. So this will be a problem. Opportunity cost will be a problem. This is what we call profitability will be less. So basically, if you understand what is cash management, it is balancing between profitability and liquidity. So the summary is, if you are in need of 10 rupees of cash, you should not hold 12 rupees. You should not have 7 rupees in hand. So having more cash is also wrong. Having less cash is also wrong. Now you may ask, Pawan sir, how exactly we can understand how much of cash is required to be held in hand? This is called OCB, optimum cash balance. So what is optimum cash balance? Optimally, that means theoretically, what is the ideal amount of cash you can hold in your hand? So this optimum cash balance can be calculated using cash management techniques. There are certain cash management techniques, and there are two cash management techniques. One is based on EOQ model. This is inventory-based management, inventory-based technique, EOQ model. Second one is stochastic model. That means based on random probability. So here we learn William J. Baumol model. So here optimum cash balance is equal to square root of 2AT divided by C. If you remember, this is exactly like your EOQ in costing. In costing, you might have studied economic order quantity is equal to square root of 2AO by C, as it is same concept, but there O stands for ordering cost. Here T stands for transaction cost. Everything else remains same. This stochastic model is Miller-Ohr model. So there are two ways in which, you know, how much of cash is to be held in hand can be calculated. This whole episode is a step two. That means category two problems. What is category one problem? Calculation of working capital requirement. Category two is, what is the amount of cash that should be held in hand? Then comes category three problems. Category three problems are cash budgets. It is also a kind of forecast. So you will prepare cash budgets for, you know, next months to come or next years to come. Again, these cash budgets are broadly classified into two. First one is long-term cash budgets. Second one is short-term cash budgets. Long-term cash budgets is nothing but cash flow statement. So basically, you prepare cash flow statement for next 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. So this is a part of accounting standard 3, and you might have learnt in accounting how to prepare a cash flow statement. In financial management, we emphasize more on short-term cash budgets, like for example, monthly cash budgets. So in the exam, they will ask you, prepare monthly cash budget from April to June. Something like that question will come. So you need to prepare monthly cash budgets. This is category 3 problems. Then comes category 4. Category 4 is debtors management. This is also known as management of accounts receivable. So in this debtors management, we learn so many things, including, now if you observe how debtors is calculated, you remember in ratio analysis, you might have learned this. Debtors balance is equal to credit sales into average collection period divided by 360 days. 365 or 360, you can take as the case may be. So here, what you need to observe is, if this ACP changes, average collection period changes, debtors will change. If debtors changes, current assets will change. If current assets changes, working capital required will change. If working capital required changes, bank overdraft may change. If bank overdraft changes, interest cost may change. That means debtors have one hidden cost, interest on debtors. You call it opportunity cost, you call it interest cost. Debtors have to bear this also. That doesn't mean in reality your debtor will give you this interest also. No, when you have sold 100 rupees worth good to a customer on credit, he will come after 3 months and say, credit period is 3 months, after 3 months he'll pay 100 rupees only to you. But my point here is, for the purpose of decision making, remember, financial management is not for accounting, it is for decision making. For the purpose of decision making, that 100 rupees whatever you are charging to your customer should include an element of this interest cost also, because of the debtor, your current assets are increasing, working capital is increasing, overdraft, bank overdraft balances will increase, or the money you have to bring it to fund working capital requirements will increase, that increases interest cost. So how can I calculate return on investment on debtors? This is what we learn in debtors management. This is one episode. After that, creditors management, float management will be there. This is a very petty topic. Creditor management and float management is a very petty topic. Float is nothing but gap between two points of time. Say for example, check received. Today I have received check and check deposited in bank. And then check encashed, credited. So if there is a gap between this and this, if there is a gap between this and this, I am unable to get my cash early. So there is a lag, there is a float, there is a, you know, gap between various events. How can I reduce this? This is what we call float management, that we study as a part of working capital. This is at another category. And last category will be factoring. Last category of problems is factoring. This factoring is one area where students, you know, feel little difficulty, but trust me, this is very simple. I'll explain what is factoring also in detail, but let me tell you in a very, you know, crisp and short way what is factoring. See, when you have in your balance sheet debtors 100 lakhs, now you do not have cash. Cash is very poor. You don't have cash. So this 100 lakhs, you know that it will come after 6 months, but this 6 months you need to survive. So what to do? This debtors 100 is illiquid asset. You want to convert that into liquid asset. Debtors is one illiquid asset, not a liquid asset. You want to convert that into cash immediately. You have two options. One is pledging debtors. Second one is selling debtors. So you identify a non-banking finance company or a financier or any bank which is into factoring, and you give your debtors to them and say, boss, take this debtors, give some cash to me. It is something like discounting bills. If you have 1 lakh rupees of bill, you go to a bank, banker will calculate interest rate and say 2000 rupees I want as a commission and then or discount, then he will give you 98,000 rupees. Like that, if 100 lakhs of debtors is there, take it to a factor, negotiate with him and sell it to him and get 97 lakhs or 96 lakhs, whatever it is. Remaining balance, whatever you are losing, is nothing but your interest cost. This is category one. Category two, factor may ask you, boss, this 100 lakh rupees, your customer whom you know needs to give to you, how can I collect from them? I do not want to take the pain of collecting money from debtors. So what I do is, I'll give you a loan. So this is only financing arrangement to you. For this loan, I need some security. Give this debtors 100 lakhs as security to me. Something like, you know, hypothecation of raw materials. You are doing here, what you are doing is you are mortgaging debtors. You are mortgaging debtors to get some loan that will be repaid out of the collections. When my debtors 100 lakhs, you know, I collect this 100 lakhs from debtors, I'll pay this loan. This is factoring. So we do factoring problems also. Now what is the summary? We have discussed so many types of problems. In that, first one is how to calculate working capital requirement. So today in this video lecture, I will teach you how to calculate working capital based on current assets and current liabilities. Do you remember in your basics, even in your 11th standard, 12th standard also, or in your foundation course, or in your degree, you might have studied, you remember working capital is equal to current assets minus current liabilities. So simple equation, working capital is equal to current assets minus current liabilities. So what are we supposed to do here? Take all the current assets, list down current assets, 1 debtors, 2 raw material, 3 work in progress, 4 finished goods, 5 cash, 6 prepaid expenses, and so on, and add all these numbers. We call this as gross working capital. sum of current assets is known as gross working capital. From this, what we do is we take current liabilities, one, creditors for goods, two, creditors for expenses, what we call outstanding expenses. We add all these things. And what we do is we subtract this number from this number. So what it will become? It will become current assets minus current liabilities. So take current assets, subtract current liabilities. Current assets minus current liabilities will become your working capital, or we call it net working capital. So simple, two steps. Calculate all current assets, subtract all current liabilities. Now the question is, in the exam or in the question, if they have mentioned your debtors is 10,000 rupees, raw material is 4,000 rupees, work in progress is 3,000 rupees, finished good is 6,000 rupees, then it becomes LKG problem. Even a kindergarten student can add all these things, subtract this. It is not as simple as that. What you have to do is, you have to calculate what is the amount of raw material. You have to calculate what is the amount of work in progress. You have to calculate what is the amount of finished goods, and all these workings you should do. So I have given you one proforma. Just have a look at the screen. Calculation of working capital through current assets and current liabilities. Now, if you have observed, I have divided this into, there is one A, current assets, there is one B, current liabilities. A minus B is your C, which is net working capital. So look at current assets, raw material, work in progress, finished goods, debtors, cash, prepaid expenses, add all these things, that will become your gross working capital, and then take current liabilities, subtract it, you'll get net working capital. Sometimes what happens, to meet unforeseen contingencies, for example, you thought raw material will be 10 rupees, but on the day when you are buying raw materials, it can be 11 rupees. So there will be some cost changes, some estimation changes. That is the reason what we do is, playing safe, for safety, what we do is we maintain little more cash than what is required. That is what we call safety margin. So in the exam, if they ask you add safety margin, we will add that. If it is not given, we will not add that. So if safety margin is not required, your answer is over in step C. Current assets minus current liabilities, working capital. If safety margin is also given, then add that in D, then it becomes net working capital required, including safety margin. That is what we call total working capital required. Now the question is, how all these things are to be calculated? Now look here. One, how can I calculate raw materials? What is the closing stock of raw materials? How can I calculate? Simple. Raw material is equal to raw materials consumed into raw material holding period divided by 12. What is this? Raw material closing stock is equal to raw materials consumed into raw material holding period divided by 12. It is a simple calculation. For 12 months, if raw material required is 100 rupees, my policy is to hold 3 months of raw material in hand. For 3 months, how much it is? So you are calculating proportionately. For one full year, if raw material is so, if one full year raw material consumption is so and so, this is raw material consumption for 12 months. In this, what is the part where I am maintaining raw material in hand? Say this is 3 months, this is raw material holding period. For this 12 months, if 100 rupees is raw material consumption, for this 3 months, how much? That is what you are calculating. Simple. So second one, what is work in progress? How it is to be calculated? Work in progress is to be calculated based on works cost. So I write here works cost into work in progress holding period divided by 12. Works cost into work in progress holding period divided by 12. 3. How to calculate finished goods? Finished goods is equal to total cost, or we call it cost of goods sold, into total cost into finished goods holding period, or inventory holding period we call, divided by 12. Then we write how to calculate debtors. Debtors is equal to credit sales into average collection period divided by 12. Credit sales into average collection period divided by 12. 5. Cash usually will be given in the question, or they will tell you cash as a percentage of working capital is to be calculated, or as a percentage of current assets is to be calculated. That is easy thing, we can calculate. 6. Prepaid expenses. This also full data will be given. You need to calculate proportionately. There is no formula for that. If you have paid insurance for 12 months, if 2 months period is falling in the next accounting year, you take the total amount of insurance paid into 12, 2 by 12. Like that, you calculate. So all these things are actually very simple. But my dear friends, you need to focus on two things here. One is how to calculate this works cost. How to calculate this works cost? This is very important. Second one is debtors. There is one note point on debtors. It is not as simple as we think. So these two things in a note I will tell you first. After that we'll go and solve one problem. Okay, now look here. What is our point is here, our discussion is what is works cost. So works cost is basically nothing but raw material plus direct wages plus factory overheads. Raw materials plus direct wages plus factory overheads. If you take 100% of raw materials, 100% of direct wages, 100% of overheads, it becomes cost of production. It becomes cost of production. And these overheads may include so many things which cannot be allocated to work in progress. That is the reason we will not do it like this. We maintain an assumption that work in progress will be valued at 100% of raw material cost, but when it comes to direct materials and overheads, we have to consider only 50%. So what is this? Raw material 100% we consider, direct wages and overheads we consider only 50%. You may ask why? Simple. Observe this. Say this is production cycle. This is day 1. This is day 10. Production takes 10 days of time, for example. Here, raw material will be inserted at the beginning of the production itself. 100% of raw material will be fed into the system at the beginning of the production cycle. But wages and overheads will be incurred here. Wages and overheads will be incurred here. So, at any point of time, say for example, if you are calculating work in progress somewhere here, raw material is equal to 100%. Why? Because beginning of the production cycle itself you have put this raw material. Labor and overhead cost will be equal to percentage of completion. So I would request you to recollect your process costing, wherein, you know, opening work in progress is given, percentage of completion is given for closing work in progress, and all statement of equivalent production you calculate, and that concept. So if percentage of completion is say 70, I will take 70% of labor and overheads. But in the question, percentage of completion will not be given. So what we assume is, on an average, we assume that percentage of completion is 50%. That is the reason we take this as 50. So what is the rule? The summary is, while calculating work in progress, we have to calculate work in progress based on works cost. We have to calculate working capital based on works cost. How to calculate works cost? Take 100% of raw material, 50% of labor, 50% of overheads. On that, apply production cycle, you will get work in progress. So how to do that? Remember this formula. Work in progress is equal to 100% of raw materials plus 50% of direct wages plus overheads. This total is my works cost into work in progress holding period divided by 12. This is how we calculate work in progress. This is point number one. Second note, what I told is debtors. Debtors can be calculated either based on total cost. Debtors can be calculated based on selling price. Debtors can be calculated based on total cost. Debtors can be calculated based on selling price. If debtors is calculated based on total cost, it becomes total cost into average collection period by 12. If debtors is calculated based on selling price, it becomes sales into average collection period divided by 12. There will be a difference between this answer X rupees and this answer Y rupees. So obviously here Y will be more than X, because if sales is 100 lakhs, total cost is 80 lakhs, when you are calculating debtors on total cost, it will be lesser than debtors calculated based on sales. But this method is to be preferred. This method is to be preferred. You may ask why. Simple logic. Basic common sense is, when I go to one bank manager, when I give my project report or working capital calculation statement, and when I say, sir, this is the working capital I need, please give me a loan. Please give me a loan. He will come to this statement. He will come to this statement and he will say, I will give money for raw material, I will give money for work in progress, I will give money for finished goods. All these things I am ready to give. But in this debtors 10 rupees, 2 rupees is your profit. Why will I give your profit as a funding to you before you collect money from debtors? This is not allowed. So he will say, if you have given 10 rupees worth goods to debtor, 10 rupees is not the money blocked, it is only 8 rupees which is the cost of the sales. So one approach is calculate debtors on the basis of selling price. Another approach is calculate debtors on the basis of total cost. There is yet another approach, calculation of debtors on cash cost, wherein you need to subtract profit and you need to subtract depreciation also. Because we are doing, you know, the initial problems and all, I will not confuse you more with calculation of debtors and all. As of now, you need to keep two things in mind. Debtors can be calculated based on sales. Debtors can also be calculated based on total cost. Prefer calculation of debtors based on total cost. In initial problems, maybe one, two problems, we will calculate debtors on sales also. But going forward, in be it in exams or be it in advanced problems, we always calculate debtors only based on total cost, not based on sales. So if you remember all these things, if you remember these things, we are ready to solve problems. Before we log off today, we will see one small problem. Let me explain you the concepts with numerical examples also, which will enhance the understandability. So far we have discussed the theory. Now we will see one problem on how to calculate this working capital requirement. Let us go to the study module. In this study module, we are starting with question number 6. Important model. Though it is easy, important model. So look here. So please read the question. M Limited has a budgeted sales of 7 lakhs per annum. What is your budgeted sales? 7 lakhs. Its cost structure as a percentage of sales, its cost structure as a percentage of sales is as follows. Raw material 20%, labor 35%, overheads 15%. Raw materials are in stock for 2 weeks, finished goods are held in stock for 3 weeks, production will take 4 weeks on an average. The firm has a 4 weeks credit period from suppliers and allows 8 weeks credit to customers. If both overheads and production are accrued evenly throughout the year, what is the working capital required for M Limited? What is the working capital required for M Limited? Just observe the numbers given in the question. Observe the numbers given in the question. We'll start doing this now. Okay. So first what we do is we prepare one working note. What is our working note one? Cost structure. We prepare one cost structure. So what is this cost structure? Observe carefully. I am writing particulars, percentages given in the question, then amount rupees. So what are the particulars? We have raw materials, we have direct wages, we have overheads. We have overheads. So what is percentage of raw materials given in the question? Let us go back to the question. Raw materials they have given 20%, labor 35%, overheads 15%. So what is the percentage? 20, 35, 15. Okay, so these percentages are given on sales, which is 7 lakhs. So how to calculate this 7 lakhs into 20%? How much it is? 1,40,000. So similarly, I calculate for the other two also. 35% of 7 lakhs will come to 2,45,000. 15% of 7 lakhs comes to 1,05,000. So raw material, direct wages, overheads put together is total cost. So what is our total cost? Simple. Add all these three numbers. 70%, which is equal to 4,90,000. And they have given sales to us. Sales is equal to 100%, which is 7 lakhs. So can I say balance is profit? Profit is balancing figure here. So 30% of your sales is profit, which is equal to 2,10,000. So this is one basic income statement I have prepared. Nothing but a very small cost sheet. Basic income statement or cost sheet, you call it. So this is the basis for our calculations. Now, Look here carefully. I have considered 100% of raw materials, 100% of finished goods, 100% of raw materials, 100% of wages cost, 100% of overheads. Now, I am taking only 100% of raw materials, 50% of direct wages, 50% of overheads. So, calculate it here. This into 100% and the other two comes like this. So, what is this amount? 3,15,000. This is works cost. This is total cost. This is sales. This is raw materials. Now, look here. Raw material 1,40,000 is there. That we use for calculation of raw material closing stock and creditors. 4,90,000 we used to calculate finished goods. 3,15,000 we used to calculate work in progress. And that 7 lakhs we take for calculation of sales. So from this statement, we take the numbers to calculate working capital requirement. Just have a look at the table. Try to understand this. I'll give you 10 seconds of time. After that, we'll start. Okay, now look here, I am preparing statement showing calculation of working capital requirement. I am preparing statement showing calculation of working capital requirement. Do you remember the proforma? In that category A is current assets. Category B is current liabilities. So what we do, first we calculate current assets, then we subtract current liabilities, then it will be working capital requirement. So in this, do we have raw materials? Do we have raw materials? Yes. One, we have raw materials. Two, we have also work in progress. Three, we have finished goods. Four, we have debtors. Five, cash is not given. If cash is given, I would have taken that here. So these are my current assets. So how to calculate? Do you remember how raw materials are to be calculated? Can I say raw materials are to be calculated as raw materials consumed into raw material holding period divided by 12. If it is given in months, we take 12. If it is given in weeks, we take 52 unless otherwise specified. So this problem, if you observe, all the periods are in weeks. So instead of 12, I have to take 52 weeks in a year. Then how work in progress is to be calculated? Works cost into work in progress holding period divided by 52. Then how to calculate finished goods? Total cost into inventory holding period or finished goods holding period divided by 52. Then how to calculate debtors? In this problem, we are calculating debtors on the basis of sales, but we also can calculate based on total cost. As I told you, average collection period divided by 52. So this is how we calculate all the current assets. Now, go back to our working note. Just now we have calculated this working note. All the data, whatever the data is required for step 2, already we have prepared in working note 1 and we compiled it there. So we just take the numbers from there and make the calculations here. How raw material is to be calculated? 1,40,000 into, what is the raw material holding period given? Raw materials are held in stock for 2 weeks. So can I say 2 divided by 12. This is how we do working. And what will be the answer? Is equal to 1,40,000 into 2 divided by 12. So we have got, 2 divided by 52. We have got 5,385 rupees of raw materials. Then work in progress is to be calculated on 3,15,000. How we are taking 100% of raw material, 50% of labor, 50% of overheads, 3,15,000. So what we do is 3,15,000 into work in progress holding period. What is given in the question? The firm production takes 4 weeks on average. So I take 4 divided by 52. So if I calculate, it will be 3,15,000. 3,15,000 into 4 by 52. It came to 24,231. Then what is total cost to calculate finished goods? 4,90,000. into what is finished goods holding period? Finished goods are held in stock for 3 weeks. Raw material is for 2 weeks. Finished goods is for 3 weeks. So 3 divided by 52. How this is calculated? Is equal to 490,000 into 3 divided by 52. So this is 28,269. And debtors is calculated on sales. 7 lakhs into what is the collection period from debtors? The firm allows 8 weeks credit to customers. 8 weeks. So I take 8 by 52. 8 divided by 52. So is equal to 7 lakhs into 8 by 52. 1,07,692. This is what you got. Okay. So I have added all these things. 1,65,577. What is this? This is gross working capital. That means sum of current assets. What is gross working capital? Sum of current assets. Then B, we take current liabilities. What current liabilities we have? We have only one current liability, creditors, which is to be calculated based on creditors is to be calculated based on raw materials purchased. So here we take raw materials purchased into average payment period given by creditors divided by 52. But in this question, we don't have opening stock and closing stock of raw materials. Therefore, raw material consumption and raw material purchases will be same. If opening stocks and closing stocks are given, then I would have calculated raw material consumption is equal to opening stock of raw materials, add purchases less closing stock of raw materials. Like that, we calculate. But in this problem, it is same. 1,40,000 into what is average payment period given by creditors? It is 4 weeks. So I take into 4 divided by 52. So how to calculate this is equal to 1,40,000 into 4 divided by 52. It came to 10,769. So this is the only item. So net working capital is equal to gross working capital, which is sum of current assets minus current liabilities, that came to 1,54,808 rupees. So look at the pro forma. It is very simple calculation. A, I have listed all the current liabilities, calculated and put the numbers using numbers given in table 1. Working note is very important. Though it is very simple working note, it is very important because all the numbers in statement 2 are coming from your statement 1. So I have calculated current assets, I have subtracted current liabilities, and I said this is net working capital required. That's it. My dear friends, I hope you understand how to calculate working capital and all. So there are certain advanced problems also. In the next video lecture, I will explain you how to calculate, you know, based on cash cost model and various other new points will come, how to deal with them. Eventually, I'll take care of that. If you have any doubts, you can write it in the comment section. Thanks for watching Cap Classes, and for more videos, please do subscribe us. Thank you.